next tab really consist of some census data that is really the information that your earlier data sheet provided. So the next colored tab is public safety. While we have been discussing animals to some extent, we will begin by discussing Target Zero. Paige?
At the, just behind the tab, there are some statistics that Linda does a really good job keeping up with. She's going all the way back to our intake numbers from 2013 to 2014. There are some shifts up and down. There are a few anomalies there. I'll leave this information to you guys to go over when you like. I know that everyone has a little bit different or a little different level of interest in animal welfare and our euthanasia numbers. It is a part of our community. I mean, there's always going to be animals that are euthanized. Because we're a public shelter, you all can't designate tax dollars to take care of sick and injured animals. And sometimes the public doesn't understand that. They have an animal that's been hit by a car, or their own animal has been injured at home, and they think that animal welfare is there to come and take that dog to the vet and get it taken care of and bring it back to them. And that's simply not the case. So people aren't always excited whenever we have to explain that to them. A lot of the reasons why we have sick and injured animals in our community is because of a lack of spay and neuter. You all have animals or been around animals, and when one goes into heat, all the gentlemen want to come calling, and now you've got people who are getting out of pens and digging under fences, and females that are sending out invitations every time the wind blows, and, you know, that's usually why animals get hit, is because, you know, they're in the road, and they're hit by a car, or they're lost, or those things happen. Then we also have people who have animals that just get sick because they get older, and they simply cannot afford to take care of them anymore, and we really try to pair them with a rescue so that those folks can get some help and we can keep the animal in that home. But with that, it brings up part of what we'll talk about in Target Zero is our availability and our demographics for resources. So in a community, just like the numbers that we looked at statistically when we started talking about community, you've only got so many people in Lowndes County that have the time or the heart or the resources to be a foster or to volunteer. You see that same group of people in every county and community. But what's different to every county or community is where those volunteers go. One of the neighbors that we've partnered with that we're really building a great relationship with that I think is going to help us look at some of the things that Target Zero brings up that is a great approach to the regional cooperation that I think the state has looked for is Thomas County. In Thomas County, they have a public shelter just like we do, but instead of having the animal control department that we have, they contract with their Humane Society. That Humane Society operates under a board of directors, and then all of the volunteers that Thomas County has work for the animals in Thomas County through that Humane Society, through that shelter. They raise all the money. I think that the county only contributes maybe $50,000 to their operating budget, so it's just enough to take care of the basic. It's not even enough to keep the doors open on the shelter over there, but they depend on some of their rescue partners for grants. They have a very low cost to free spay and neuter clinic over there that we're partnering with and sending some of our animals to be spayed and neutered to reduce our adoption fees for especially cats right now. But what we have whenever you take that group of volunteers in our community is we have several local rescues who are very active in pulling animals from our shelter. They raise money so that when we do have someone who comes into the shelter and they're sick or injured, they pull that animal out so that we don't have to euthanize it. And so we try not to raise additional funds as a local public shelter, because just like there's only so many volunteers, there's only so many dollars in the community that are going to go towards those things. So again, in Thomas County, you've got volunteers that are raising those dollars that are going directly into the shelter and into their spay and neuter program. And what we have here is those volunteers and those dollars that are operating individual rescues that are pulling those sick and injured, and also huge contributors to our adoption rates, because they come into the shelter and for however many fosters they've got room, they pull that many animals out of the shelter. And then those are the animals that you see at PetSmart and at the Humane Society. They take a lot of our cats and put them into their facility there. So neither option is probably any better than the other. It's just the demographic of your community and where those volunteers have chosen to go.
Who owns the shelter in Thomas County? Is it
owned by
the county?
Humane Society.
So they own and operate the facility.
Okay. Yeah. And then they have a contract for animal control and for the very basic of, you know, the pickup of animals and those types of things. And financially, Thomas County's demographic also is a little bit different than ours. You've got some families and some groups there, because you've got that one-stop shop for kind of everything animal-related in that community that you've also got all that money funneling into. Where in Lowndes County, some of the benefactors and the families that we have that are available to do that are working individually through our local rescues. So I think maybe one thing that they do a little better than us is in Thomas County, you've got all of those efforts pulling the same wagon in one direction, where here we've got multiple wagons that are, for the most part, going in the same direction. So we're a little bit more diversified.
So all the people on place. Saturday at PetSmart are volunteer people trying to foster out?
Yes.
No?
Yes.
It's a zoo up there.
It is, literally, absolutely. But if those volunteers didn't do that, you would see our euthanasia rates for dogs go up tremendously. Go ahead.
I was just going to bring your attention to item number 3 on the intake reasons, impounded animals with owners. Does that mean that we need, that we're required to provide shelter, food, and health care for the owners as well as the animal?
Mr. Chairman, sometimes is the expectation,
yeah. And I was kind of thinking along the same line. Sometimes the owners need to come with the animals.
Thank you for that.
That's a good place to start. I'm on Charter Zero, so thank you for that transition. I have given you guys a clean copy of the Target Zero report. Target Zero came in back during the summer. They are an organization that is made up of experts in the animal field from across the country. They volunteer their time to be a part of the Target Zero organization. They adhere to best management practices that they have seen shelters and communities use across the nation to reduce the number of animals that they're taking into the shelter, and by that they're reducing their euthanasia numbers. So there are a few things that we're going to talk about that are in this report that whenever you all have time, if you feel so inclined to read every word of it, like I think I have about 20 times, that are not quite accurate. The process is set up to create that just a little bit, because basically what they do is they set a time to come into your shelter, they do a walkthrough, they talk to your employees, and there's no follow-up after that. They just go back and do their report and send it to you. Again, being that, you know, we're dealing with a group of volunteers through with this, because it didn't cost us any money to do that, we have to remember that they're not a consultant. You don't have that same process that you would have with a consultant to probably get a little better data that's 100% accurate. Exactly. So on page 3, you'll see that a lot of these sections start with things that the county is doing well and or opportunities for improvement. So down at the bottom, you'll see that bulleted list. The Best Friends Annual Society grants is Sioux County Leadership to the Annual Conference. once we met with Target Zero and became aware that there were some scholarship opportunities for some of this training that we did not have in our budget. We took what was in the budget and used that for travel and took advantage of those scholarships where we could. There's not a post equivalent of training for animal control officers or shelter staff like you see with jail and with probation and with law enforcement or even fire through the National Fire Association. So it's a little bit hard to find training. We have partnered with Animal Law Source out of the Atlanta area. They've kind of become our go-to for cases in court that have some anomalous things that we've not looked at before. So we are already moving towards or more at speed as far as training goes. The Sunlight Project, the Coalition for Information Exchange between Thomas and Lowndes Counties, we are meeting with Carol, who is the owner and operator of a cat shelter in Thomas County that is dialed into several state and national associations, one of them being PetSmart, another being FixGeorgiaPets.org, that have grant funds that are available to have pets spayed and neutered, which again reduces our fees that we have to pay. That we have to charge citizens to adopt an animal. Right now, we are, depending on what additional money is available, at $125 for cats and $150 for dogs. That is way more expensive than most people can afford, going back to what we looked at as far as, you know, our average income here. It doesn't mean that these people can't afford to be pet owners. It just means that they can't come off that much money at that time to adopt a pet. So we are really high as far as our adoption fees go, and so we need to work on that. But we are filling in the hole about $5 on every adoption. The majority of that money is going directly to the vets here locally for the spay neuter and the rabies vaccination. So there's no revenue whenever we looked at our finances and you saw that that revenue was declining. There's no, we're not making any money. You know, we're trying to make ourselves whole the best we can, but if we go up any more, we are certainly going to price ourselves out of the market there.
I would add this right along with what Paige just said, and again, I like to kind of use real life examples. But if it was not for my son, my daughter, one of my daughter-in-law would probably be one of the biggest rescuers in the county. I mean, she loves dogs and cats.
Emily.
Yeah. And she rescued a dog from, she worked for us over at the Thomasville store right after they got married, and she rescued a little dog from over there. And she said the experience that she had going through that process, number one, it was relatively inexpensive to do it, and they were a newlywed couple, so she just fell in love with this little dog over there, which is still with the family today. And so the easier that process can be made and the lower cost that it can be made, when it's costing $150, you're not too far away at that point of being able to afford a registered pet, animal, puppy, if you choose to go in that direction, rather than utilizing the resources that the county has to adopt some of these pets that can be wonderful pets. I know Biscuit, that's her name. She is just a sweetheart, you know, and so if we can improve this process and make this easier, make adoption more affordable and the accessibility to the adoption process easier as well, smoother, then I think that we can have an impact to our adoption rates, which in turn reduces the ultimately euthanasia rates at the same time.
Well, absolutely, and I don't want to say too much yesterday whenever we were talking about facilities, because I wasn't sure in what direction Mr. Pritchard's size 15 and a half over here was going to go if I did say too much. But the other comparison that we see, because you do have people who look at, you know, come to our shelter to look for pets, and they go to shelters in the surrounding area, Thomasville being one of them. About the shelter facility itself, that shelter was built before we had a Chad. I think that, you know, Chad deserves all the credit in the world under Mr. Pritchard's leadership, because you all have been around enough to see the facilities that he has been a part of, the projects that he's been a part of, and how efficient they in turn are for the public and the benefit that's there. And the shelter is no different, but because we didn't have him when the other shelter was built, and because it was done with a lot of cooks in the kitchen at the time, which is part of the material issue that we have, the flow of that building is not conducive to people going into the shelter, seeing these animals as pets in an environment that's one that they actually want to bring them home and bring them, you know, into their family. So in looking at options as far as the shelter goes, whether you go in the direction of trying to, you know, do something with what we have or something else, not only do we need to meet those Department of Ag and USDA regulations, but we also need to make sure that it's a fair environment for the public to come into and to be a part of that process. And it's easy to do. The current floor plan of the shelter, though, is just not that. For instance, if we have, you know, a wild dog or cat that has to come in now and go into one of the hole rooms, the only way to get that dog or cat into the room where it has to be held as a stray is to bring it down the very same hallway that the public is walking down while they're trying to go and look at adoptable pets. And, you know, that's not a good environment. Your daughter-in-law would come unglued if she saw a dog flopping around on the end of a loop stick while she's trying to take the twins in to look at a new kitten. And so people don't like to come to the shelter because people have seen things like that, and it's just there should be a different flow so that animal control can bring those animals in and they can be looked at and evaluated in a safe environment without the public being a part or having to witness that process. On page 4, real quick, technology and data. We are using a free software program right now, a free version of PetPoint, which doesn't allow a lot of flexibility. The shelter staff is researching what it would cost to use the paid versions of that so that we can look at some of the recommendations here. Also, something that Mr. Pritchard had already recommended when we were talking about the tablets is right now everything there is being done on paper. So we want to go to a tablet system there, which will cut the time down for the employees that it takes to bring an animal in, process them, and get them to an adoption room. It'll cut that time down by 75%. So that's a big saver as far as them being able to do other things, keep the shelter cleaner, have more time to spend, you know, walking the dogs and getting them out and those kind of things. You turn over on page 5. Budget operations and grant opportunities. Basically, the team did not like that our budget wasn't any larger than it was. We all agreed that you all have been very adequate in the budget that you have provided for what the service is asked for. I think that this is like some other things, though, as far as the expectation and what Commissioner Weisenbaker was referring to at lunch. You know, 20 years ago, and before that, when I started working for the county, we had a shelter that was not as big as this room on Douglas Avenue that was a little phone in the front with a single light bulb hanging from the ceiling and a gas chamber in the back and a yard with a chain link fence. That was it. And that was where citizens at that time, that was their expectation for animal control and for pets. There wasn't a movement for adoption. People were not looking to rescue animals. They were just looking to get them off the street. Well, over the last 20 years, we have gone through all of the improvements, and some of them growing pains, to get where we are today, which is light years from where we were, but we're still not where we need to be based on you know, these best management practices and the opinion of some of our citizens. Now, you have to balance that. There are some people who don't have their dogs that sleep in their bed at night like some of us do. Some people don't let their dogs inside. Some people would like for you to pay all the rates with their tax dollars and never spend a penny on animals in our community. So there is a balance there, and we're aware of that. But there are some changes. And what we've done with this report, whenever it came through, Mr. Pritchard said, look at what makes sense as far as policy goes and do what you can do that's not going to have an impact on the budget. Then take the next level of things and look at, can we reallocate resources to help some of these things? Then get down to, okay, we need the final list of what's actually going to impact the budget. And that's kind of where we are today. our intake hours, one of the things that Target Zero really pushes is to make sure that you've got more hours available for people to come in and adopt than you do your willingness to take animals in that are being turned into the shelter. And that really does make sense. And that's an easy change that we can make that will actually make the staff happy because they have more time to spend with people on adoptions instead of intakes. We've also, and if you read the report, this is recommended as well, we've also tried to work with people to the extent that we can to see what can we help you with resource-wise if that's the problem, to help you keep your animal. That is a big concept that's helped a lot of communities decrease their euthanasia rates. Sometimes it's a situation where someone's out of a job and they're having a hard time making ends meet and they just don't have the resources to buy dog food. Sometimes it's that, you know, they had a puppy that they were keeping in the house that they thought was going to be an inside dog and they realized that's not working with their family. Now they need to put it outside and they don't have the funds to buy a tether or a dog house. We have a lot of resources that we can call and people in the community, including the rescues, that can help people through that process. If we just have the time to say, okay, I understand that you want to get us your dog, but why is that? So we're trying to help people keep their dogs in their homes through that process. We're also to control the number of animals that are coming into the shelter, trying to see if there's a way to get them directly to rescue. You know, sometimes it's a situation where, you know, an adult child ends up with a dog because it was belongs to their mom or their dad and there's been a death in the family and now I've got this dog but I've also got terrible allergies so I have it for now because my mom loved it but I can't keep it. There's no reason for that animal to come into the shelter. We incur costs whenever that happens and ultimately that dog's going to go to rescue anyway. So let us get you with a rescue and let that dog grow directly to PetSmart so that it can quickly find a new home instead of coming into the shelter, getting up a respiratory infection, or acting aggressively towards other dogs because it's not used to being around other dogs, and now we have to euthanize it for behavioral purposes. That's really a lot of what Target Zero is about. So we know that the building is in need of repairs. We didn't even point that out to us.
Before you jump, I want to get that real quick. Question. Their comment on, let's say, the good things and the bad things.
What page are you on?
I'm trying to go back to it. Basically, where they said that they didn't feel like that Lowndes County provided budget opportunities.
Yes.
Leadership depends on donation from other agencies as opposed to requesting baseline budget.
Right. So.
And we said Thomasville. For it, under their models, the county is contributing $50,000 to that process. We're spending almost $400,000.
Right, so what they're looking at, you can't compare apples to apples there,
right,
because our system's not set up like Thomas County's is.
Right.
What they were talking about is that we do accept donations for toys and cat litter and those $100 PVC pipe beds that go into adoption rooms for the dogs to keep them off the floor, that type of stuff. We don't budget for those things because we always have people who are wanting to donate them to us. So that's one of those things that's really not accurate about this report.
Okay.
And that whenever I sat down with the staff and, you know, we all talked about it, they don't feel like they're being slighted on the budget. Of course, employees would always like more. But during the last budget, you all increased their budget that took care of supplies and some new uniforms and things like that. Mm-hmm. And then the tablets that we talked about as far as the technology for intake, we've included those in the upcoming budget. One of the recommendations that Mr. Pritchard had just before Target Zero came through, but it was after the budget had been adopted, was for us to put scanners, microchip scanners, in all the trucks. Again, if you're really trying to decrease the number of animals that you bring into the shelter, then whenever, you know, we find PJ running down the road, let's scan him and see where he lives. And if we can just go take him back and put him back over the fence and leave a note on the door that says, hey, animal control was here, we put your dog back in the fence, please check the gate or whatever, then, again, we don't need him coming into the shelter. We don't need him getting sick. We don't need people getting aggravated because after the stray hold is up, they've showed up the day after, and we've already rescued their dog out, and now the dog's gone. Right. The other thing related to that is, and this was something that was decided by a former commission, we used to hold dogs and cats for 3 days once they came into the shelter, for 3 business days. What we're seeing is that a lot of the pets, if you look at our reclamation numbers and the number of owner reclaims we have, people don't care that their animal is out. I know most of us would be stroking if we got home and the dog wasn't in the pen, or if we walked in the house and the dog didn't meet us at the door. But there are a lot of people who don't care for their animals at that level. And when they go missing, they just went missing. And so we don't do a lot of reclaims through the shelter. But the longer we hold the dog or the cat, the more it costs as far as boarding and possible vet fees and the likelihood that the animal's going to get sick, and then we're going to have to euthanize it because it got sick, or we're going to have to treat it. So we used to have a 3-day stray hold. We went to a 5-day stray hold, and Target Zero is recommending that we go either back to a 3-day, and so is staff, and for cats, that we decrease that even more, because it is hardly ever that anyone reclaims a cat from the shelter, and cats are at the biggest risk for upper respiratory infection, and we have to euthanize them once that happens. It's very contagious, it's airborne. The cat cages are right by each other, so if one cat has it, there's a good chance that the cat next to it is going to catch it. And overall, our euthanasia numbers are so high because of the number of the cats that we're having to put down. It's not necessarily the number of dogs. Dogs are easy to get out. Dogs go to rescue. People adopt dogs. You just don't have as many cat lovers, not just in our community, but in many communities. And so cats are really what are adding to that overall number. So we would like for you all to consider us working on that stray hold number and going back down to at least 3 days instead of 5. Especially being that if we upgrade the Pet Point software, then we're going to have other opportunities as far as social media to get photographs of these dogs out that we have in the shelter, so people can look after hours on Saturdays if the shelter's already closed to see if their animal is at the shelter instead of actually having to come down whenever we're open. But that is a policy that's one of those best management practices that is recommended as far as decreasing their overall numbers. So that's something for you to think about there.
So, Paige, will you and the staff take these public policy recommendations and go through those and see which ones we actually could insert into our ordinance? Because I can see some of them that are, to some degree, contradictory in things we're already doing.
They are. And there's two things. I heard you say tethering.
Yeah.
That is not true. One of the animal control officers who Mr. Pritchard took care of on a policy violation unrelated to anything about Target Zero was just disgruntled in general and didn't like to get called in and, you know, have to come in after hours or take call or whatever. We are not seeing an increase in the number of dogs that are strays or that are out or that people are calling on due to the tethering. Quite the opposite. Citizens have really caught on to the tethering, and we have them calling the officers to say, you know, either they're saying, I just need to make sure I got this thing set up right, or if they've got a larger dog, or if they've got a situation as far as there's no shade in their yard, they're now asking us to come out and say, I don't want to be in violation, but I want you to look at my yard and see what kind of recommendations you have, because this is all I have to work with, and I need to make sure that I do this correctly. So we're seeing very positive response to the tethering now, and that's going really well. And that helps with aggression.
Since there's mention, that's the one that jumped out at me as well.
Yeah, that is totally not. In fact, I talked to the officers about it last week whenever we met about court, and they're like, no, absolutely not. I heard from Carol over in Thomasville the end of the week. There is a grant that she's asked if you're interested in partnering with her on that will put money into the spay neuter clinic over in Thomasville. FixStorageOfPet.org awarded them a really nice like panel bus that's huge. They can put like 30 And they take them over to Thomasville, and they spay neuter them for little to no cost, and they bring them back the same day. So we are loading up and utilizing them as much as we can. The problem is they're a little overwhelmed number-wise. Ideally, we would get on our feet enough with this that we could apply for a grant that would build, that would put one of those spay neuter clinics here. They have two vets that are on staff that are paid for through that process. I know one of the things that it says in here is you read that we should, have local veterinarians that are willing to partner and help out with. That is simply not the case. The voucher program that the Humane Society uses, it's a little bit difficult to get vets that will take that. The other problem that we have with that goes back to what we started talking about today after solid waste, is that, you know, people only have that $50 or $60 that voucher requires them to pay for that spay and neuter. They don't have the other $1,000 that it's going to cost you to get out of there the first time. By the time they want to clean their teeth and, you know, give them the pampering service and all those other things that they want you to do, people just want to go in for a spay and neuter, and there's just not many vet offices locally that will do that.
We could, another little bit of humor, but we could take a van such as that and put doors and panels on it, and where the pet would be visible to the citizens, and drive it down the streets with a jingle and a bell on it, like an ice cream truck. And when the kids run out,
yeah,
here's your pet, go get some.
Go get mama. Here's the dog.
Take this paper and I'll tell your mama just a sign right here.
You only got 30 cents in your pocket. We'll take it. Here you go.
Hey, mama, thank you.
So, Thomasville has done a lot of things that have made significant impact there. And as those things relate here and we can take advantage of those, we are trying to move in that direction as well. Part of that, again, is related to the cats, and I want to talk about them real quick so that you know, and hopefully that foot won't kick out again. So our current ordinance talks about trap and release for feral cats. You all may know, because of the complaints that you sometimes get from apartment complexes, or if you pull up behind certain restaurants here in town after dark and shine your lights, there's just cats, the dumpster cats, that come out from everywhere. There's also some other locations that are just out in the county that, for whatever random reason, a cat colony formed there, and there's cats. We have some families in our community that have been maintaining these colonies privately for generations, and they even partner with their friends on, if you and I are taking care of a colony and I need to go on vacation and I normally feed on Mondays and Wednesdays and your Tuesdays and Thursdays, I'm going to call you and say, hey, you got them all 4 days this week because I'm going to be out of town. I mean, that's the level that they check on these colonies. And for the most part, the property owners around there have, you know that they're there and have accepted that they're there. Colony cats are, they're scooped up and caught. They are spayed or neutered. They're vaccinated to the extent that they can be. And then they tip one of their ears so that if they come into the shelter, if someone catches them in a trap, if they get lost somewhere, because not all feral cats will scratch your eyes out. Some of them are quite friendly, believe it or not. Then we call the Humane Society, and the cats are microchipped, so normally they can scan them and tell where the cat came from, and they just take the cats back.
That happened to me. I trapped the cat, took it to an animal shelter in the trap, went back there and said, look, I got this cat, I don't, he showed up and took it back. I was feeling out of faith. And the girl came out and talking to one of the others and said, this cat's got a tip here. I said, what does that mean? I said, well, it's been spayed.
It's calling a cat.
I said, well, give me that cat back. I took it home. Put it back around the barn. Been there ever since.
See? Yay!
But who knows that a tipped ear means something?
Right.
I didn't.
Yeah. So we had a situation with a citizen about 2 months ago, and this is what we have started doing. When people call in and they say, I've got these cats in my yard, it started out as three cats, and now I've got 30 cats, we say, okay, what do you want done with the cats? Do you want the cats gone, or do you just want there to not be 90 cats? Are you ready to stop this? Because usually people have been feeding them, which is why they stay. And a lot of times they're fine with them being there, especially if they have property or if they, you know, want to keep the mice out of the barn or whatever. So we partner with the Humane Society. Their volunteers go out, they scoop up all the cats, trap them all out of there, take them through whatever program and have them spayed and neutered, take them right back, and life goes on. Statistics show that once a cat colony has formed, you can't really eradicate it. You can go in there, you can scoop them all up, you can euthanize them all, and a few weeks later, there's going to be cats back. I mean, it's just how it happens. So a better method, according to Target Zero, Best Friends, which is a national organization, and really all of the others, says that you can have policies like we currently do and continue to euthanize thousands of cats every year because they're just going to make more and we're just going to keep killing them. Or you can look more at the trap and release program approach and spay neuter these cats, put them back, and that keeps their numbers down. I know that doesn't make sense, but I have read books, I have read studies, I have looked at this extensively because I used to really think before all of that, you know, that makes no sense whatsoever. I mean, it really doesn't. But all of the data supports.
It makes perfectly good sense. You spay and neuter and continue to do that through a colony, you're going to basically eventually kill the colony.
Right. Eventually, they through whatever.
Let me ask you something on that. I'm sure it's going on. If you eliminate the colony, either by spay and neuter or whatever means of exterminating the cats, where do the others come from? You say, do the cat colonies know that we carried some away, so they move over there, or the other ones move because they say, well, I know that they're neutered, so I guess we'll move over there.
That is a very good question, Mr. Pritchard, and I'm so glad that you asked. Because I can't answer that.
I mean, there is a logic to this somewhere along the way.
Sure. So, just like people who go deer hunting, there is a tree with a hole in it that is within sight of one of the stands, deer stands on our farm, that my granddaddy over the years on purpose would not tell people this so that everybody could be surprised by it. But the hole in that tree always had a family of raccoons living in it. So you could be in that deer stand and think that, you know, I'm just out here with the deer and looking out that way, and you'd see this little furry head pop up, and sometimes the babies would be running up and down the tree. So it was entertainment for that deer stand. For generations of raccoons, there was always a raccoon in the hole in that tree. It was the environment, and it's no different with these cats. And then whenever you have citizens who are looking to get rid of a cat that don't want to feel bad by taking it to the shelter and dropping it off knowing that it's probably going to be euthanized, when they see people feeding these colonies, and when they see cats out and around, it makes them feel better to say, well, I'm going to drop my cat off where it's going to have friends. So, you know, now it's going to be...
Somebody's going to take care of it.
And so that's how...
justified in my own mind.
Right. So that's why maintaining the colonies is so important, and that you have those colony keepers, which certainly we have so many volunteers in our community that are willing to do that. But again, it means that whenever cats come into the shelter, that we send them through this program that's not going to cost us any money to get them spayed and neutered. And then we ask that person who brought the cat to the shelter, if this cat was spayed or neutered and not making more cats, would you be willing to put it back where you found it? And, you know, we've already done it just to try on a few. And people are like, sure. I really didn't want to bring it to you to begin with because I felt like it was going to be euthanized. You know, I don't mind it, you know, being in my yard or being, you know, in the woods behind my house or whatever, as long as I know that there's not going to be a litter after the fact. So that is probably the biggest change in mindset, change in policy that comes out of Target Zero. But I think that it's one that can make a big difference in our euthanasia numbers. You know, the point of Target Zero, it stands for really getting to, you know, zero euthanasias, and I think that that's not practical because we are going to have these dogs and cats that are so severely injured that the minute they get to the shelter, the most humane thing to do is to euthanize them. But it means that we've got policies in place that are not requiring us to euthanize animals that there could have been another option for.
Well, I mean, it's obvious, and of course, I would encourage the commissioners to continue to dive into that information and understand it well, but, you know, animal control and animal care in this community is still part of our responsibility. And any way that we can look at on trying to improve not only the animal welfare, but the efficiency level and the financial responsibilities that we have as a county toward that, the better we can utilize those dollars for the biggest effect is ultimately where we want to be at. So if we can continue to work in that direction, and it's not anything that we're going to be able to fix immediately, but I think it's something that we can continue to improve on.
Two things just real quick. On page 9, there it was reported that the trucks break down and are not temperature controlled. That came from that same officer that was talking about the tethering, and that is not the case. Robin's team does a fantastic job of maintaining our trucks, and they all have air conditioning. Also, there was a question in here about the chemical that we use to clean the shelter not being pet friendly. We use the very same active ingredient that they reference. We just don't use the same brand name that they were familiar with, so I think that's what that confusion was about. Also, one of the things that I was probably most disappointed about is the communities that they compared us to are not similar to us in size, demographic, or otherwise. So that's kind of useless data in here because you really can't compare South Georgia to Waco, Texas. That's just not practical. So anyway, as you go through, you may have some more questions. There's some other inaccuracies in here, and I'll be glad to clear that up as best as possible.
Any comments?